Today we are going to start with the basics of PDEs. What I mean by that is, what we want to talk about is, the first question should be, what is a PDE, right? What is PDE? And basically what we want to talk here, I mean, obviously along with the definition, we want to say that we want to distinguish. Maybe that is a second question. Difference between PDE and then ODE, right? So that's the second question. The third question, Q3, what is it? It is that we want to classify the PDEs, okay? Classify PDE. Based on linearity, okay? Linearity, okay? So that's the third question. The fourth question should be, we want to find some strategies, okay? Strategies for studying PDEs. For studying PDE, okay? So let us answer the first question. What is PDE? So PDE, definition. So here, whenever we are saying PDE, we will always assume that omega, right, is an open domain, which is a subset of Rn for some n. Yes, n can be. So here n can be 1, 2, 3, okay? But most of the times we will assume that n is greater than equal 3, okay? But so maybe a small note, we will generally assume n is always greater than equal 3. I mean, for n equals to 1, it will turn out to be a PDE is an ODE, and that is by definition a PDE also, but we call those an ODE. So just to distinguish between a PDE and ODE, we just call it n greater than equal to. There are more distinctions, so we'll come to that later. Okay, so that's the PDE. Now, that's the domain which you are talking about, so that is an open domain. Now, the thing is this, what is a PDE? So an expression, so PDE, so this is the definition, right? So an expression on a relation f of, so let me start by defining maybe a second order, okay? A second order PDE, right? So D2U x is equals to 0, right? All of this depends on x. So whenever I'm specifying x, D2U of x, I haven't wrote it, but this is the thing. The relation, something like this, this is equals to 0 for x in omega is called a second order PDE, where f, this is the relation from what to where? See, D2U. So let me remind you, u, let's say, okay, it depends on where you are starting from. Let's say u subset omega subset of R2 to R. So what is D2U? If you remember, D2U is uxx, uxy, uyy, yx, uyy, right? So that's a 2x2 matrix, right? So if you are looking for D2U, but U is from omega subset of Rn to R, yes, then this this particular thing is a subset of R n square, right? D to U. So the for n equals to, so when omega is a subset of R n, D to U is a subset of R n square. So if, so here I am assuming omega is subset of R n. So if D to U for a fixed x, right? D to U is an element of R n square. And then you have du. Du is just the gradient of u, and in this case it is an element of R n, right? So you see, in this case, what is du? Du is essentially the gradient of u, which is given by ux and uy, right? So in n dimension, it is ux1, ux2, uxn. So basically, that's an element of, so here it is an element of R2, and in that case, it's an element of R n, right? So, and u of x, usually we assume u to be a function from Rn to R, right? It's a real valued function. So u of x is a real. So this is R times x, we are assuming to be an element from omega, which is a subset of Rn. So this is again from Rn to, f of all of this is 0, right? So this is a real valued function. So, where f is given by this, is given, and you will be given u from omega to r, sorry, this is the unknown, u from omega to r is the unknown. Okay, so basically what is a PD? It's nothing but a relation which is on D to U, DU, U, X is equals to 0. Okay, now let us understand this particular thing with some examples. So, some notes. So, this definition I just gave it for just to make life simple, second order. If you want to make it a kth order, so let's say kth order, okay, kth order PD, how should it look like? So, kth order PD will look like this. It is f of dk u, dk minus 1 u, du, u, x equals to 0, right? So it becomes more complicated, that's all. So where f, if you see dk u, in that case, it will be an element of r n power q, okay? So this is r n k, r n k minus 1 times R n R omega to R. Okay. There is a small mistake which I did. See, here when I am defining D to U is in R n square, D U is in R n, U is in R, right? U of X is in R. And this X is in R n obviously, but this X I am taking it from omega. So this R n is not right. I have to change it to omega. Clear? So let me change it to omega, right? It is obviously subset of 1, but it should be omega, right? So here for a kth order equation, it looks like this. Let us look at some examples. So let's say Laplacian of u, right? Yeah, it is defined by uxx plus uxy. Let's concentrate only on the two-dimensional version, or let's say, you know, let us concentrate only on the two-dimensional version with second order equation. Okay, so this is uxx plus uyy equals to 0. So you can see that this is a PD. Why? Because what is the function here? F of du ux. If you define it like this, what is this? This is basically the trace of D to U, right? If you define f to be the trace of D to U, so essentially, here I wrote it like this: D to U is an element of R n square, right? Yeah. And whenever I'm basically writing it as a trace, I'm assuming that R n square, you just write the elements of R n square, and you just take the diagonal elements there, add it up. That's your trace. And in this case, f of d to u, du, ux is defined by this. Once you define it like this, trace of d to u is equal to 0 will give you Laplacian this, right? And that's your PD. That's one example. So let's look at another example, easy example, UX plus UI equals to CUI. Okay, that is the example of a transport equation. Now, if we want to look at this thing as a PDE, how should we write it? See, this is the first order PDE, right? First order, because the highest derivative which is involved in the equation is 1, right? So f of du u x, how should it look like? F of du u x, you can see that you can just write f of du. So this is nothing but the, so du is ux and ui, right, in two dimension, let's say. Yeah, so if you write this thing properly, du is ux, ui, u, x, right? If you write this thing properly, it should look like this, no? And then you can obviously write it as u x plus u y. So if you're defining your f like this, obviously f of this is equal to 0 will give you the PDE, which is given by ux plus ui equals to 0. Okay. Now, once we know all of this, what we can do is we can talk about the different classifications of PDE. Okay. Classifications of PDE. Now, PDE can be classified in a many different ways, and most probably you have heard about classifications of PDE, second order linear PDEs, okay, based on the nature of the PDE. So based on the determinant of the highest order, so essentially, you know, you basically look at b square minus 4ac terms and the sign of this, and then you talk about ellipticity, parabolicity and all that. Here we are not going to do that. Here what we are going to do is, let's say you are given a PDE, right? You are given any PDE. I mean, I don't care if it is a linear PDE, non-linear, linear PDE or not. If given any PDE, I want to classify those PDEs. And what I'm going to do is, I'm going to classify those as per linearity. Okay. So first definition which I'm going to write is linear PDE. Okay. So what is a linear PDE? Linear PDE is a PDE, so a partial differential equation, okay. So here I will just write it like this. D, let's say KU DK minus 1 U, U X equals to 0 in omega. So let's say that's the PDE which you are working with. So PDE star, okay, it's called linear if it is of the form, if it is of the form mod alpha less than equal k a alpha of x d alpha of u is equals to f of x, right? So for some f, okay, I don't care, it is given. So for some given f, if this f, the expression of f looks like this, so this is the a alpha of x d alpha of u. So basically the power of the all the derivative should not be more than 1. So in that case, and obviously there are some coefficients involved with every derivative. If it looks like this, then we call it a linear PDE, right? And this is for some function f, and some function a alpha, okay, mod alpha less than k, right? Okay, so. And moreover, such a PDE is called homogeneous if f is equal to 0. So if f is equal to 0, it's called homogeneous equation. If f not equal to 0, it's a inhomogeneous equation. Okay. So let us look at one example our basic example which we looked at in the last part, ux plus cy equals to 0. If you write it like this, or equals to 0 equals to f, I mean, it does not matter here. Ux plus cy equals to 0, let's say. Now, this is an example of a first order linear PDE, right? Linear PDE, right? So, because alpha is here, if you look at it, alpha will be 1. Alpha is 1. So, first order linear PDE. This is the first example. And the second example we have already seen, uxx plus uyy equals to 0. Let's say this equation. Now, do you think it's a linear PDE? Of course, it's a linear PDE because the highest order terms, I mean, the derivatives, okay? Uxx and uy, these are the highest order derivatives. And the power of the highest order derivative is always 1, right? So, and the coefficients a alpha in this case are all 1. So, this is a second order linear PDE. Alpha equals to 2. Okay. So let me give you another example. So let's say this equation uxx plus 2uyy, okay, plus let's say x square ux plus y square uy equals to, let us assume u on u, okay. So if you just write it like this, plus sin x, something like this, huh? Plus sin x. Or, I mean, I don't care, you can just move the sin x around or make it 0, okay? But let's say this is the equation given. So, again, you see, this is in this form. Why? Because all the derivatives, so this, let's say this derivative, the coefficient is 1. All the coefficient here is a function of x, right? A alpha of x. All the coefficients here are functions of x, x square. And here also it is a function of, so basically whenever I think x, x is in Rn, right? So, here xy is in R2. So this is a function of xy, which is 1, function of xy, function of xy, function of xy, function of xy, which is 1 here, and function of xy, okay? So all is right, correct, and d alpha of u, alpha is 2 here, alpha is 1 here, alpha is 1 here, alpha is 0 here, right? And that's the constant. So essentially here, in this case, what is happening? In this case, we have, it is a second order linear PDE, right? But you see, if you change this thing to, let's say, u is changed to u square or something, okay? So let me put it this way. So let's say if I am change u to u square, yeah? Then do you think this is a linear PDE? No, because you see, in that case, there is a term of u which contains square terms, right? Square terms, and here there is no square terms. So u and all its derivative should be purely in a linear form. So only 1, okay? U, the power of u is only 1. That is only allowed. No u square, u cube, nothing, okay? So if this is there, it's not a linear PDE, correct? Okay, continue our discussion on the classification of PDEs, and now we are going to define the semilinear PDE. So, semilinear PDE. Now, what is semilinear PDE? Okay, so we are essentially talking about the k order PDE here. So, the PDE, let's say this PDE, f of dku, dk minus 1 u, ux equals to 0. This PDE is called semilinear, right? If it has the form summation mod alpha equals to k, a alpha of x d alpha of u is equals to, so essentially here the first we just look at the highest order term, okay, mod alpha equals to k, and the highest order term should only contain a alpha of x, right? It should not contain anything else except the coefficient, the coefficients of this. See, of course course, the highest order term has to be linear. Okay, linearly new. So essentially, the power should not contain any square, cube, and all that sort of thing. And along with that, the coefficients here are very important. This should be only functions of x, right? Okay, and so this should look like this is equals to, or you can just write it like this, plus some, let's say, a naught. A naught is another function, and this function may not depend only on x, but depends on dk minus 1 of u, dk minus 2 of u, d of u, u, x is equals to 0, right? So if it looks like this, then we basically have a semi-linear PD. So essentially, what is the idea here? The idea here is this. See, we are not bothering the highest order term. Linear equations, all of these terms have to be linear in every, you know, order. But here, we just look at the highest order term. We are not bothering with that. That has to be linear, okay? Dt, d alpha of u, the power of that has to be 1. And that coefficient corresponding to that should be only function of x, okay? And nothing. Okay, but the next terms, so the k minus 1 order terms and u, e, x, all those terms, that can be a linear or a nonlinear function. Okay, so this where a naught, okay, is some given function. Okay, I don't care what a naught is, a naught can be linear, a naught can be nonlinear, right? So let's look at an example. Let's say ux plus cy. Okay, so this is the first example. Let's say this is equals to u square. Now you see the highest order term here is 1, right? And the coefficient, so a alpha of xy in this case. Yeah, see here x is, here I am taking for this thing, x is in omega, right? Which is a subset of Rn. This I am taking it to be a subset of Rn. So x is x1, x2, xn. Here x and y is in R2. It's a two tuple. Here x is x1, x2, xn is in omega, which is a subset of Rn. Here xy is in R2. So the coefficient, so in this case, a alpha of x, whenever I think, it means a alpha of x1, x2, xn. Yeah? So here, the coefficient here, so a alpha of xy, all of these coefficients are 1, right? And what is your a0 of xy, what is that? This is, as you can see, so it is not only a function of xy, right? So a0 of xy should be written as a0 of x, so it is u x y, this should be equals u square. If you write it like this, then this equation, then 1 is a semi-linear equation, right? See, it is linear in the highest order terms, right? And after that, the lowest order terms, I don't care, it can be linear, it can be non-linear. So u square, if you change it to u e power u, then also it is a non-linear equation. These are non-linear equations, but we classify it as a semi-linear equation in this sense. So it's a semilinear equation. Okay, so now that we know there is a subtle difference between linear equation and a semilinear equation, in the sense that linear equations has to be linear in every order. Here, semilinear, we are just looking at the highest order, and that should be linear in the highest order terms. Okay, and after that, the lower order terms, I don't care, that can be nonlinear. Okay, now with that, I will classify more. So, and a small note here which I want to point out is this. See, linear equations are semilinear equations. Okay, so linear equations are contained in semilinear equations, class of semilinear equations. So linear equations can be classified as a semilinear equation, okay? But a semilinear equation cannot be called a linear equation. But converse is not true, right? Converse is not true. So essentially, you can cannot call a semilinear equation as a linear equation, but you can do the other way. Okay, so now let's look at another type of classification, which is called a quasi-linear PDE. Okay, PDE. So the PDE f of DKU, DK minus 1 U, U x, this is equal to 0, is called quasi-linear if it is of the form. So here what we are going to do is we are going to allow the highest order term to be function of k minus 1 order terms. Okay, so mod alpha is equals to k a alpha of dk minus 1 of u d of u u x, and this is the highest order term d alpha of u. Okay, so the kth order term, the coefficient of k order can contain the coefficient can contain dk minus 1 of u d u u x, but not dk of u. Okay, up till k minus 1 d alpha of u, and then plus a naught of dk minus 1 of u d of u u x equals to 0 in omega, right? So this sort of equation is called a quasi-linear equation. Okay, so let us look at some, and obviously where a alpha, where those are given, a alpha and a naught are given functions. Given functions, right? Okay, so let us look at an example. So let's say u ux plus uy equals to, let's say, sin x, right? So that's an equation, and you can see clearly this is definitely not a linear equation, because the highest order term, you see, the derivative ux, the first order derivative ux, the coefficient of this is neither a constant nor a function of x, but u is involved here, right? So definitely that's not a semi-linear equation nor a linear equation, but this is definitely a quasi-linear equation, because here a alpha of du ux is basically u, right? Okay, see, here I can, a alpha should not contain du, right? A alpha should not contain du, because the highest order term is ux and uy, 1. Okay, so it should not contain. So a alpha in this case is only a function of x, u, and that is given by u. Okay, here a alpha of x, u is u, and a naught of, again, k is 1 here, so it is u x is given by sine x. Okay, and then this particular equation is in this form, and hence this is a first order quasi-linear equation, right? This is a first order quasi-linear equation. Now let us look at another example. This will make it more clear. Example, so let's say to u x u x x plus u y u x y plus u u y y is equals to 0. Okay, now you see, let's look at, this is a second order equation, right? This is a second order equation, but the coefficients, a, let's say, alpha of du u and x here is given by ux. Okay, here it is ux, uy, and u. So if you just write it like this, it is, let's say, okay, let me put it this way. Summation a alpha of du and d alpha of u mod alpha equals to k. This part will look like this, no? Ux, that is your a alpha of this, the first for alpha, so this is uxa. This is for alpha equals to k equals to, in this case k equals to 2, right? K equals to 2, and alpha in this case, so k equals to 2, Yeah. What is UXX? It is D20U. Okay. So if you want to write it, you can write it like this, but I'm just writing it like this. UY, UXY. So UXY is what? UXY is D11 of U. Okay. And similarly, UYY is D02 of U. Okay. You can write it like this, or you can write it like this. U, UYY. So you see the highest order term. Derivative UXX, UXY, UYY, the coefficients are maximum. Here it is UX, the function of UX, function of UY or U, but it should not be UXX or UXY. The coefficients cannot be that. Okay, right. So that is called a quasi-linear equation. So it is kind of very similar to a semi-linear equation, but little bit more than a semi-linear equation. So here a small note is this. A semi-linear equation, obviously, equation is also quasi-linear, right? Quasi-linear. Obviously, you can put it in this form, but not the converse. So, the converse is not true. Clear? Okay. And now, the main, the most important thing is the definition of non-linear equation. Okay, so what is a non-linear equation? The PDE f of dk of u, dk minus 1 of u, d of u, u x equals to 0 is fully non-linear. Okay, fully non-linear if it depends non-linearly, okay, very important, upon the highest order term. Okay, highest order term. So what I mean by this is, you see, here the coefficients does not contain highest order. If you allow those coefficients to contain highest order, then the highest order coefficient. So here, you know, what is the highest order derivative? UXX, UXY, UYY. The coefficient should not contain, for quasi-linear cases, any, you know, UXYX, UXY, those sort of things. So anything below is okay. So if that is the case with your equation, then it's called a non-linear equation. So let's look at the example. So the first example of a non-linear equation is this. UXX, let's say, square, yeah, is equals to 1. Yeah, of course, this is a fully non-linear equation, right? So this is a second order fully non-linear equation. Okay, let us look at another example. So now the example which I am giving are very, very important examples. So these examples are from, let's say, given by two, determinant of D2U equals to 1. Okay, so this is called a Monge-Ampere equation. This is a prime example of how fully nonlinear equations look like. The point is this: see, fully nonlinear equations are much harder to solve. So why we are doing all this? Let me explain to you. So more or less, you have now the idea of what nonlinear, quasi-linear, semi-linear, and linear equations are, right? So let me explain to you why we need all this classification. See, the point is this: linear equations are the easiest to solve. Linear equations, okay, easiest to solve. Now, the more nonlinear it becomes, the more harder it is. So basically, you see, linear equation, semi-linear equation, let's say, okay, these are much harder than linear equations. Okay, so somewhat harder, somewhat harder. Okay, so see, linear equations, semi-linear equations behave much like linear equation, okay, but a little different. I mean, okay, so they are basically, they are somehow a linear equation, obviously in the highest order term. So their behavior is somewhat like linear equation, but I mean, of course, the lower order terms are non-linear, so the behavior changes and it becomes a little harder. Now, quasi-linear equations are much different than linear equations. So they are much harder than linear equations, but they are very close to semi-linear equations, right? Okay, so these are harder to solve, harder problems to solve, okay? And now when you go to fully non-linear, from here, fully non-linear equations, you understand that there is no bound here. I mean, you can have any sort of equation here that you like, and that's a fully non-linear equation, and this is the hardest to solve, okay? And unfortunately or fortunately, whatever you want to call it, most of the equations which we encounter in our, you know, from programming, the real life phenomena, they are all fully nonlinear equations. So they are hardest equation to solve. Let us now talk about the differences between an ODE and BDE. So difference between an ODE and a BDE. So you see, whenever we are talking about an ODE, let's say you have a function, okay, u from let's say an interval I, which is a subset of R to R. So it's a real valued function defined on an interval I, and a relation which will look like this. So let's say f of uk of x, uk minus 1 of x, and u of x equals to 0. This sort of equation is called a kth order ODE, right? So essentially what is happening is we are looking at a function, real valued function defined on an interval I. So here the derivatives are only, you know, u squared u cubed, so our usual derivatives. But so this is an ODE, but for a PDE you have u from omega subset of, let's say, Rn to R, right? Okay, and here there are many different things involved. So, and a relation which looks like this, f of, so uk will be changed to dk of u, and du u x equals to 0, this sort of thing. Yeah, so this is a kth order PDE. Okay, now what is the difference? See, here what is happening is we are talking about the gradient of u, which is again ux and uy, and you have d2u, let's say, that is, I mean, in a two dimension, n equals to 2, and d2u is uxx, uxy, uyx, and uyy. Okay, so you see, and this will go on for dk of u, and you can understand that this here, okay, we are talking about a multivariable function, and that is why the derivative, the second order derivative, the kth order derivative, these expressions become much more difficult, and the equations itself becomes much more complicated relation. Okay, the relation itself becomes much more complicated as opposed to the ODE, which we already encountered in our previous studies. Okay, so essentially what is the difference between ODE and PDE? The difference between ODE and PDE, in ODE we study functions which is real valued function but on a domain which is in R. In PDE we study real valued function, okay, but I mean real valued PDE is, if we are talking about equations, real valued function, but they are defined on omega, which is a subset of Rn, and omega is an open bounded set, right? So you have the equations involved are much more complicated. So let me make it a small note. PDE are much more complicated than ODEs. Okay, we will see that. I mean, when you solve a PODE, let's say, yeah. So let's look at this example. Let's say another small example. Let's look at which will give you a clear distinction between an ODE and PDE. Let's say this equation U prime equals to zero. Yes, U prime equals to zero. Now the solution for this equation. So now U is from AB to R. That is the unknown, and I want to find U. You can see that U of X is always constant, right? A constant. Constant. So it can be 1, it can be 2, whatever. It's just a constant. So that's an ODE. ODE. Now let's take the same sort of equation, but in a PDE form. UX is equals to 0, let's say. Yeah? And U is a function of XY, right? That's your U. So you see, if you want to solve this equation, you can solve it. Of course, you can solve it. Just take the integration on both sides. But the solution will be some function of y, right? For some c, right? For some c. Now, you can see the distinction. Here, the solution is a constant. Here, the solution can be constant, of course, but in general, it is a function of y and not a constant. So, essentially here, in ODEs and PDEs, in PDEs generally, in ODEs where we have a constant, in PDEs, those constants are getting replaced with some function. Okay, and I mean, similarly, you can go on doing this. So essentially, this is a huge, you understand, I mean, when you change the constant to arbitrary function, the whole structure of the equation changes. I mean, the idea of what the solutions are, and I mean, all our theory which we learned in ODEs, those has to be changed in the theory of PDE. So this is the real distinction. Now, let's understand something called about the strategies for solving PDE. So you understood that solving PDE is much difficult than solving an ODE. Okay. Now let's look at a strategy. Strategies for solving PDE. So what are the strategies? Okay, so whenever we want to study a PDE, let's say, for solving PDE is like a wrong thing to say. We should say, so this is, this should more like this. This should be like, it's not solving PDE, but studying PDE. Okay. Okay. So what I mean by this, we do not want to solve a PDE. Yeah. We want to study a PDE. And what I mean by this is something called a well-posedness. Well-posedness. So what does that mean? Well-posedness of a PDE. What does that mean? It means that let's say you are given any PDE. Yeah. So let us assume the given PDE. Okay. Let's take a second order equation. You can take kth order, but I don't want to. Let's stick to the second order equation. Given a PDE like this, okay, I want to talk about the well-posedness. So what does the well-posedness mean here? So well-posedness is the first thing is this. If you want to study this PDE, the first thing you want to show is the existence of solution. Existence of solution. Okay. So what I mean by this is, see, most of the times when we study PDE, it is not possible. Please understand this thing. Given a PDE, it is not always possible to find a solution, explicit solution, yeah, of that particular PDE. Okay. But with the help of some theory, we can, of course, say that whether there are solutions or not. These are not explicit solutions. We can just say that there are solutions or not, okay? I don't know what the exact solution looks like, but I know that if there is solution or not. If that is the case, then you have an existence. So basically, existence of thing is, if, let's say this is one, if one admits a solution. Now the thing is, one admits the solution. This is again a controversial statement. Okay, admits the solution. What do I mean by solution? Those things will come to later. Okay, The second portion, so well poisonous consists of three parts. The first is existence of solution, which actually guarantees that there is a solution. Number two is the uniqueness of solution. So let's say that you are modeling a particular physical phenomena. Okay, you got a PDE and you solved the PDE, you got the solution, right? Now, if you get two different solutions, yeah, then the question is, what are you going to take? I mean, it is obviously a nice thing to have uniqueness, right? That if you know that there is only one solution, then you do not have to choose between those two or between infinite number of solutions, right? If you know that there is exactly one solution, okay? And that actually helps with our theory also, that if the uniqueness holds. So essentially, uniqueness of solution is, if solution exists, solution exists, it is unique. Okay, so essentially you see, first what I want to say is, let's say you are given an equation, first you want to see that if it has a solution, whatever that means, yeah, and then you want to see that if there is a solution, the solution is unique or not. Okay, so let us take this other example, the last example which we talked about, ux equals to 0. This example, ux equals to 0. Okay, u is a function of x and y. Now you see, this example, u of xy is phi of y. Phi is arbitrary. So there are arbitrary, obviously there is a solution, right? Existence solution, there is a solution. Some way, there is a solution. But is it unique? Definitely, this is not unique. Why? Because phi is arbitrary, there can be infinitely many solutions. So uxy equals to 1, 2, whatever, these are all solutions. Uxy equals to y, y square, all of those are solutions. Okay, so the uniqueness is violated here. Okay, so this thing is not well posed, this equation. There is another part of well-posedness. This is a very important part. This is called the continuous dependence. Continuous dependence, okay? This we will talk about later. So what it means, I mean, now I'm just explaining the exact mathematical formulation is a little complicated. We will look at it later. So what it means is the solution depends continuously, okay, on the data given in the problem. Oh, what I mean by this is, let's say that you are given an equation which looks like this. Let's say f of du u x equals to 0, and u restricted to some gamma, okay? So let's say this is in omega, and gamma is some condition, okay? Data is given along some curve on omega. So let's say this is g, yeah? So that's the equation. Now you see, let's say that's your u, and gamma is a boundary. Let us assume that gamma is del omega. Just assuming, this is omega, gamma is del omega. Now you see what this particular thing says is, let's say that you solve this equation with on the boundary u, and the boundary is g. Let's say that you know that there is a solution and the solution is unique, good for you. And unique for this g, right? Given this g, the solution is unique, let's say. Now what happens is this, let's say I change this to this. So let's say 1, I want to change it to 2, okay? And how does 2 look like? It looks like this, du u x equals to 0 in omega, and u restricted gamma is g plus epsilon, okay? So, and here epsilon positive. So, what I'm suggesting is this, you just take g, but you know, shift the g to g plus epsilon, a little perturbation of g. Now, what you see, this, let's say this solution is u, and this solution is u epsilon, yeah? You definitely want u epsilon to be very close to u, whatever that means, huh? So we want u epsilon to be very close to u, right? Should be very close to u. That's the mean in general perception. For some equations it holds, for some equation it does not. Okay. So if it does not hold, then you do not have a well-posedness and the solution does not continuously depend on the data. Clear? So once you are given a PD, if these three hold, so first of all, existence, if there is a solution or not, whether there is a, if there is a solution, the solution has to be unique, and if it is unique, then the solution has to continuously, very important, yes, it depends on the data given in the problem. If those two three conditions hold, then we call the PD as a well-posed PD, okay? Right, now before we move on, I want to explain one more simple concept, the concept of solution. Solution to PD. See, whenever we are looking at a PD, we are saying we can solve the PD and all that thing. But whenever we say we can solve a PD, what does that mean? This is a very important concept. Please understand this thing. Yeah. Let's say I look at this equation. D2u, du, u, x equals to 0. There is nothing special about 2. You can write it as dku and, you know, kth order PD. So let's say this is in omega. Okay, so x is in from omega. So this is the PD which I'm assuming. Definition, yeah? Definition. Let's say this is 1. By a solution, okay? 1, we mean a function u in C2 omega, right? So essentially what is happening is this. See, here, whenever in this course, whenever we are saying something is a solution, what I mean is you are looking, so basically you see, this thing has to, any u which satisfies this sort of equation has to have d2u, du, u, and x. All of this has to be defined, and, you know, we want this to be continuous. Otherwise, you know, it does not make sense. So you see, there is an expression which contains d2u, du, u, and x. D2u, du, all of this has to be, has to exist, right? And we are also assuming they are continuous. So we mean a function u which is in C2 of omega. So that is the address of u, where u resides. U is in C2 of omega, and u solves 1. Okay, u solves 1 for every x in omega. Yeah? So what I want is this. See, first of all, u is in C2 of omega, and it also has to solve this equation for every x in omega. Yeah. If that is the case, then we say this is a solution of PD, this sort of solution. So essentially, this kind of solution are called, these kinds of solutions are called classical solutions. Classical solutions. Okay. Now, why are we suddenly talking about all these solutions or not? You see, most often than not, you may it may happen that we cannot find a classical solution. Okay. And there are other concepts of solutions which are called weak solutions and I mean strong solutions, weak solutions, or that sort of concept, but those are not contained in this syllabus. They are scope beyond the scope of this course, and whenever in this course we are saying something is a solution, we say that it's a classical solution. So let's just take one small example and understand what I mean by this. Let's say ux equals to 0, right? And so this in R2, so essentially what I'm saying is u is a function of x and y. So as you can see, that function of y, u of xy, if it is a function of y for some phi, okay, then is a solution, right? U of xy is a phi of y is a solution, okay? Now question is, what sort of solution is this thing? This is a classical solution, right? This is a classical solution. When? See, phi, if u of xy equals to phi of y, it should at least be differentiable with respect to x, okay? See, if, let's say, you are taking such a phi for which phi of x does not exist, okay? Then that implies ux is not defined, right? Is not defined. And hence, ux equals to 0 does not make sense. So this sort of phi does not make sense, right? This does not make sense. So this sort of phi does not work, right? We want a fee for which all of UX equals to zero makes sense. So basically, fee should be differentiable with respect to Y. Here we are taking much more. We are saying that fee is C1 of R2. Okay, so basically it is differentiable with respect to X and it is differentiable with respect to Y, and such that fee, okay, fee is a fee here, it is just a function of R, so you do not have to take it to be in R2, you can just assume it to be in R. Okay, fee, you can just assume it to be R. It's just a function of one variable, right? So fee is assumed to be one. If it is just C1 of R, then you can see in this case, in particular in this case, U of X or U of Y is well defined. Okay, so fee is in C1 and that is given to be a solution.